You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Most writers and radio show hosts know that to connect with your fans, you need to do more than just write books or record the latest podcasts. There are many different elements that go into forming an online platform, but there are also many hidden traps. To make matters worse, solid advice on how to survive the muddy waters is scarce. In the book Hidden Traps, I talk about some of the important issues of working with an online platform, highlighting traps that could put your physical or internet security at risk or be harmful to your reputation. Are your social media posts just links with a few disjointed words making you look like someone who can't complete a sentence? Did your new website cost you more than you anticipated? Are you leaking your personal contact details across the web without even knowing it? Then you need Hidden Traps. Hidden Traps is now available in paperback and ebook from a variety of retailers, including Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and Kobo. Visit blackwolfpublications.com for more details.
Do you need a car? Been shopping only to be turned down because of bad credit, low credit, no credit, bankruptcy, or divorce? Guess what? Today's your lucky day, because now you can buy a car, truck, or SUV, just about any vehicle. It's true. Bad credit? Doesn't matter. No credit? Doesn't matter. Bankruptcy or divorce? It just doesn't matter. As a matter of fact, your job is your ticket to your new vehicle. We're Auto Credit Express, and we've helped thousands of people just like you. Antonio H. told us, great company, got me connected, and the day I went in, I drove off in the car I wanted. 100% worth your time. Need a car? Get started now and drive off as early as today. Just text FINANCE, F-I-N-A-N-C-E, to 357-911 right now to get started. That's FINANCE, F-I-N-A-N-C-E, to 357-911. Auto financing the easy way. Text FINANCE to 357-911.
KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com.
Everyone loves liberty. Our rights come from God, not the government. So why are you letting other people tell you what's best for your health care? Exercise your freedom with Liberty HealthShare. Liberty HealthShare is a community of people who voluntarily share one another's medical costs. Liberty HealthShare is founded on the idea that most people truly want to help one another. Healthcare sharing allows members to do just that as a true community that supports one another in times of need. Liberty believes people should make decisions for themselves and their families. Members are able to take back the freedom to make their own decisions about their health care. Freedom from guilt or doubt about how your money is used. You have the freedom to direct your health care, not to be dictated to by bureaucrats. Stop letting others tell you what to do and join a community of like-minded people. Exercise your freedom. Join Liberty HealthShare and take back the control of your health care while helping those around you. Call Liberty at 855-58-LIBERTY. Again, that's 855-58-LIBERTY for more information, or you can check them out at libertyhealthshare.org. Again, that's libertyhealthshare.org.
My son was in the Army back during Desert Storm. But even then, he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq. Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now, 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
At St. Jude, a family never sees a bill at all. It's like the world has been lifted off of your shoulders.
St. Jude Children's Research Hospital, finding cures, saving children. Learn more at stjude.org.
Sometimes writers feel lost, unsure why a passage may not be working. takes another set of eyes to help us nurture our writing into full maturity. At Black Wolf Editorial Services, we strive to enable writers to develop and grow, offering manuscript critiques and line edits through a mentoring editorial style. We also offer assistance on generating a writer's bio for your websites. Black Wolf Editorial Services, nurturing your writing into maturity. For a full list of services, visit blackwolfeditorial.com.
You're listening to the Spark Radio Network, internet radio like you've never heard before. Innovation, creativity, and imagination are all said to begin with a spark. So fasten your seatbelt and take the ride of your life and listen for the spark.
And so, my fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country.
Freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. We didn't pass it on to our children in the bloodstream. The only way they can inherit the freedom we have known is if we fight for it, protect it, defend it, and then hand it to them with the well-taught lessons of how they in their lifetime must do the same.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am Rick Robinson. I am one half of the crew. You are listening to the Jen and Rick Show. She's the other half of the crew, Miss Jen Homestead, and we are live right now on KLRNradio.com, where liberty and reason still reign. So for those of you who were tuning in expecting to hear me at 9 Eastern, I am still planning on doing the America Off the Rails show at 11 Eastern. We moved it back to the old time slot because my programming director has been taking priority again. We have three new shows hitting the schedule here in about the next 2 weeks. First one will be tomorrow night. This is actually going to be a monthly show. It'll be in G's normal time slot where we do the conservative curmudgeon. Once a month, he's decided to give up his time slot so he, Ordy, and I can do a new show together once a month called Toxic Masculinity. So that will be airing tomorrow night in G's normal time slot, which means I'll be behind a mic for 3 hours in a row tomorrow. I really should be planning these things better.
get those throat lozenges ready.
Yeah, something. Anyway, so tonight I'll be live for 2 hours, and then I'll get the morning update stuff ready to go, and then I've got some finishing touches to put on the stuff for tomorrow. And so the other stuff we've got going on is it's been officially announced the Red Wine, formerly with AltCon Radio, is actually coming over to KLRN Radio. They're still going to be affiliated with AltCon, and Hammy is welcome anytime, but they have been pressuring him to get a show started again, and he seemed to be not really that interested. So they're like, can we come do a show over here? I was like, I've been trying to get Hammy to let you guys do your show over here, even if it was either a simulcast or a replay back since the K98 days. So yeah, you can come do a show over here. So they are starting not this coming Friday, but the following Friday. So tomorrow night we have Toxic Masculinity. A week from Friday, we have the Red Wine joining us. And then a week from Sunday, we have JD and Stacy returning with Game On. So two very, very high-octane groups of folks that bring in lots of listeners, and then you have me, Ordy, and G. So, take with that what you wish.
Very nice, very nice.
So, what have you been up to, other than the fact that you ditched me last week to go hang out with Timberlake? I was kind of sick.
Yes, I did go see Justin Timberlake in Dallas, and that was so much fun. I had the best time. I've just been working. I had a huge event last night. So I have basically, since I got back from Dallas, I've just been preparing for that. And for anybody that doesn't really know, whenever like a special event goes on, it's long. The event is only 4 hours or so, and it's a lot of fun, and it's a lot of lights and you know, just show. But, you know, there's days of load in and overnight loadouts and long hours and all on your feet, all sorts of craziness going on. So that's what I've been doing. I finally crawled into bed at like 4:30 in the morning last night. So if I start to sound like my voice is trailing off a little bit, it's because I'm trying to stay awake.
Nice.
This is one of those. So I just have to say, and this is no offense to teachers, but it's one of those where I saw like a tweet earlier today from someone that calls themselves like fixing education or something. And I got blocked for what I said, but their tweet said like things that my non-teacher friends get to do. And it was like, go pee, like go out for lunch, have a 15-minute conversation, you know, leisurely conversation with their coworker. Actually do paperwork for their job during their job day, like blah, 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 blah. It was all this kind of like woe's me stuff. And like I said, no offense to teachers. And I know a lot of really good teachers and a lot of them are very hardworking and quite a few of them are underpaid. And I know that they take work home and I know that they're very invested in their students and that it's not just a, you know, 9-to-5 job. But this is not abnormal. Like this is how a lot of jobs are. And so all I said was, you know, this is not unique to the teaching profession. There are a lot of jobs that are like this. What I will say is the little caveat here is most of those jobs are year round and teaching is not. So that's, it just comes off a little bit, you know, martyrish when that's not the case. So my last couple of days are an example of that. I was like, oh, really? You didn't get to go pee or have a leisurely conversation? I'm like, I didn't sit down for almost 20 hours, you know? I mean, I got there at 7:30 in the morning and got home at 4:30 in the morning, and I don't get to sit down. I am constantly walking, constantly carrying stuff, constantly answering questions, moving things, directing people where to go, coordinating vendors, talking to fire and police. Like it's just nonstop of, and every time I think I have a second, it's, Jen, can I ask you a question? Jen, do you have a minute? So Jen, like every time I turn around. So, if I hadn't had a caterer there last night who has worked with me before and knows me and came and found me and shoved a chicken sandwich in my hand, I probably wouldn't have eaten either because that's how it goes. So, you know, lots of jobs are hard and lots of people work really hard and they don't all have, you know, a lot of free time throughout the workday and they don't get some perks that maybe some people do. But I think I think what she described is more common for most working people than not.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I mean, here's my thing, and this is going to sound pretty callous, but I mean, to me, teachers have a pretty cushy job when you stop and think about it. I mean, they're inside climate-controlled buildings most of the time. If the weather's bad, most of the time they don't have to go to work. I mean, it's the same with me. I work in a profession where I'm inside all the time now. That didn't used to be the case. I used to have to work when everybody else was on holidays. Now I have holidays off.
Right.
I have a set schedule. I have an office. I sit in a cube. I talk on the phone and help agents and teach agents and take escalated calls and things like that. So, I mean, it's not like what I do is hard. Now, that doesn't mean that what I do isn't stressful because there are moments when I'm a little cranky. But when I comparatively think about what I used to do for a living versus what I do now, I'm very, very lucky. And that's one of the things that kind of drives me crazy when we have all these people. Like, I was going to pull the audio for it and I didn't have time. There was an epic smackdown that Ben Shapiro put on somebody at a conference the other day because they were talking about, you know, the need of labor versus capital and how one needs one more than the other. And so the dude kept trying to talk about, you know, like pencil factories. And, you know, you need workers to put together pencils because you have all the individual pieces, but the sum of its parts they're more effective when you put them together and they're more expensive. And so he kept saying, the kid kept trying to say, well, if you're only one guy trying to make pencils, you're not going to get very far because you need workers. And Ben's like, but I have millions of people that will voluntarily put them together for me because I'm willing to pay them a wage to do so. So your argument doesn't make any sense. And that's the thing that people need to understand is, you know, for all of you that are complaining about the jobs that you have, there are other people that will gladly take your place.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think I just kind of get really tired of this kind of warfare between professions, particularly coming from certain like places. And it's always people that think they're more educated and they work harder than anyone else. We see this with the journalists, you know, with a lot in the journalist class. We see a lot of teachers do this, professors do this. And then sometimes it does come from, you know, other like more educated professions like doctors and lawyers. But it seems like the really heavily academic side of things, like people that lean that way, tend to kind of scold people that are not in those kinds of professions, and then always try to make it seem like theirs are harder than anyone else's. And I just think that a lot of professions are hard. I think most people work hard in their job, no matter if it's being a busboy or whether it's being, you know, a Supreme Court justice, and that it all involves hard work and discipline and sacrifice. And when people are really good at their job, they're going to give all of those. They're going to give 110%. And so, you know, not having all of these certain, you know, accommodations, I just don't think is very unique to teachers alone. Ask nurses about their chance to pee and go out for lunch and have a leisurely conversation. I mean, that it's just, I just get sick of this kind of like, oh, well, we are the ones that have it bad, and all of you who have other jobs don't understand our pain. And I'm like saying, no, I think a lot of us do understand. We just have it all a little bit differently. And you kind of sound like a snotty brat.
Yeah. I don't understand why everybody thinks that their experience is more pertinent than anyone else's. And I get that, because we are selfish people at heart. So I mean, I understand it to a point, but at the same time, for all these people that think, well, I'm better than you because I'm more educated than you are. No, because most of the people that I know that have very, very extensive degrees don't have enough common sense to light a light bulb.
Yeah, I mean, it does vary, right? And there are different kinds of intelligence. There's, you know, very academic-oriented intelligence. There's even, like, you know, like levels of intelligence within there. Like, is it very specific? Is it more general? Are you highly educated because you have multiple degrees? Or are you highly educated because you have expertise in a very specific field that has gone to, you know, you've gone to a great extent to achieve. There's emotional intelligence. There is, you know, psychological intelligence. There's all kinds of ways for people to be very smart, and most of them have nothing to do with earning a degree. Even though I do think that can be the beginning of a measure for someone it can measure certain things about someone that can be beneficial to an employer, but it does not say, that does not mean that they are smarter than other people who don't have degrees. That's just absolutely ridiculous.
Yeah, I mean, the whole idea that intelligence is measured by education is insane. It really is. I mean, I get it. You know, if you're taking the time to get a doctorate, then obviously you're a fairly intelligent person. But to think that because you have a doctorate, you're more intelligent than people that don't, that makes absolutely no sense to me, because, I mean, that's like my son. I have a son who got bored with high school, basically ran off because we were making him go to high school, went to go live with his aunt, got his GED, and scored off the charts in every single area because he was really, really smart. He just hated school.
Yeah. No, and like, and I have a lot of respect for people that can recognize, can like be self-aware. You know, I have someone in my family who has a master's and often reminds everyone that she has a master's and kind of uses that as like why she should win this argument with you or why she knows better than you. That is obnoxious, and that is not in any way a measure of her being in any way particularly more informed on one subject than we are. And then I have another guy who has a doctorate who is exceedingly humble and consistent, and he is brilliant and consistently is like, oh my gosh, you would know more about that than me. You are way smarter than me. And it's like, oh my gosh, no, I'm not. You have freaking a million degrees. But, you know, but he has a sense about him that is just very, like I said, self-aware. He's just very, he's going to be pretty humble, and he's going to recognize like where his strengths are and where they're not. And even some of them I think are his strengths. And he's like, oh no, but I don't know any more than you. He doesn't assume that because he has degrees, that means that he is smarter than anyone else that he is talking to at any given time. And he respects everyone for what they actually bring to the table, not for some sort of superficial thing.
As it should be.
Right. So, anyways, that was a fun little random intro. Oh, and I wanted to hit on one other thing real quick before we start getting political about anything. I don't know if everybody saw on Twitter. I know like most of the people that we kind of interact with on Twitter were sharing this, but there was an Air Force veteran that passed away. He was a Vietnam War vet, and he passed away and from right outside of Austin here. And it kind of went viral because the funeral home reached out to several news stations and asked them if they would broadcast that. They couldn't find any family. They couldn't find anyone, and they were afraid that he was going to have a funeral attended by nobody. And so they wanted to get the word out that if there were any veterans in the area that could make it to his funeral, or anybody that just wanted to come pay their respects, that you know, they hoped that people would do so. And obviously they gave the address there in Killeen. And turns out that last Monday there ended up being 5,000 people. They were in line. Their car, the procession, had cars backed up for miles and miles and miles, and 5,000 strangers showed up to pay their respects to this man who, you know, sacrificed for this country and didn't have anyone in the end, or not that anyone knew of, and so he got his full military burial and was, you know, sent to heaven with a large group of people praying for his soul and thanking him for his time, for the time he spent serving our country. So I just thought that that was really, really cool. It was so neat to see. It's like, that is just where you're like, this is America. This is who Americans are.
Yeah, actually, believe it or not, and I actually have some pictures that we'll be putting out. Somebody that has been with the station in the past was actually at the services. Jessica Sanders actually sent me some pictures from there. She actually was showing the line of the cars and all the people that were there. It was just, it was kind of amazing. So I actually plan on putting some of the pictures of that out over the weekend on the station account. So
it is amazing. I would have gone if I could have, but I was working. But it was like, I mean, and I knew some people that did go, but it is really cool. And if anybody just wants to Google it, you can go see all of it too. And then, you know, obviously there were law enforcement and firefighters and everybody that came out and like lined the processional route to give him a final salute. Anyways, I just find that so special. And it just reminds me that there's still like a lot of really good people in America that are ready to come together and be respectful and, you know, send a great man off.
Yeah, I don't know. It amazes me the number of people that we would, if we looked into it, we would probably find out actually had nobody to show up for things like that. There's a few things that I've always wanted to do, and one of them is to put together kind of a veterans group to help both not only, you know, during their return, but if they need help with things, you know, like housing, other things, and just ways to help them in general. But another thing, if I can ever find a way to get that started, that I would like to add into that is just making sure that nobody that ever serves this country ever gets buried alone.
Yeah, and so actually this is a funeral home, thankfully, that cooperates with a program that actually George P. Bush started that's called Texas Veterans. It's a program for Texas veterans who died alone that they try to reach out to funeral homes, and that if they come across any of this, then they can be a part of it, and so that they can get their full military honors, because a lot of times they won't get their full military honors burial if the proper authorities have not been contacted of their passing. So they can't get that military burial without it. So we need the cooperation of hospitals and funeral homes that are trying to do this to be able to reach out, at least in Texas, to reach out to the program to make sure that more people like Joseph Walker of the Air Force, who was just buried, are able to receive that. And then they also help spread the word about the funeral for anybody who wants to pay respects. So that's been going on since about 2015, I think. And I know it's been pretty successful, but the hardest thing is getting the word out, to get notified at all that someone has passed that is a veteran. That's the hardest part. So I hope this was kind of an example, and more people that are involved in the postmortem process will kind of think about this and see if there's some way to reach out, and maybe we can allow for more of these veterans to not be buried alone.
Yeah, I mean, even if it's just in some small way, I think everybody should find a way to see if maybe there's a group in their area that they could become involved in that helps with that type of stuff. So, I mean, at this point, probably is about time to start delving into some of the political stuff, because it's not like there's not enough to talk about. So, the shutdown's over. Donald Trump's been taken to task pretty hardcore about the fact that he at least according to some folks, has caved. I'm one of the ones looking at it going, I don't understand how we got all the way to this point just for us to wind up right back where we started from. Because for those keeping score, this was the CR, the clean CR that Donald Trump originally told everybody he was going to sign until basically Ann Coulter and Rush Limbaugh started weighing in. So I have it on very good authority that Donald Trump has made some enemies in high places in D.C. from backing out from something that they thought they had his cooperation for just because some pundits turned his head. So this could be bad.
Yeah. You know, I kind of always thought there would be a caving. I just thought it would go down a little bit differently. But, you know, and I certainly did not expect the Democrats to cave. So it was going to have to come down to Trump. But, you know, this entire thing has been so framed so dishonestly. And it's I just think it was always a lose-lose. No matter what he did, I think it was going to be a losing situation. I think he had to press for it, and I think he had to allow it to shut down, and I think he had to cave. It's not what I want, but I think that that was always going to be the way it had to go, and that just really kind of stinks because it seems, like you said, you're just right back where you started, that it was all for nothing.
Well, so here's the things that I have learned from the shutdown. First of all, we could have been right back where we are right now without anybody losing any paychecks, because if he had passed the original CR that was agreed to, they would have still been looking at things coming to a halt right about February 15th if they'd passed the one that everybody was talking about back in December. So that's problem number one with all of this, is because he could have not had the shutdown situation and used that couple of months span to keep pounding the idea about border security, or even better, instead of starting there, pass the CR, pound Nancy Pelosi into the dirt about the fact that she kept saying she wanted a permanent tax cut for the middle class, prove to the American people that she's a liar. Use that first. Use her own words against her to prove who it is that actually is trying to fight for us. There are ways that he could have spun this in a way that would have helped, but at the same time, even when he caved, he did it wrong. If he would have stood in front of the American people and said, you have seen me come back to the table with these individuals twice, and they will not budge. You have seen vote after vote after vote where the Republicans are trying to get the people that are currently furloughed paid so we can continue to negotiate to make sure that we're putting something in place that keeps you safe, but they keep voting against it. For those reasons, I'm reopening the government and giving them 2 weeks to figure out whether they're going to be for you or against you. And if he would have used that the day that he said he was reopening, he would have turned the argument on its head. But he didn't. And even now, he had a chance to spin the argument back around. Because Chuck Schumer, in his gotcha moment, with the glasses down, like he's talking like he's the principal of a high school. Mr. Trump, I hope you've learned your lesson. No more shutdowns. This shutdown cost the American people $11 billion, $3 billion of which we're never going to get back because it's gone. No more shutdowns, Mr. President. So what you're telling me is, if you would have given him the $5.7 billion that you were supposed to give him in the first place, you'd be 5.3 ahead. Not to mention the $3 billion that's gone forever because nobody's ever going to be able to see it again. You jackass.
Mm-hmm.
Ugh, the whole thing just makes me mad. Mad, I tell you.
Yeah. I mean, I think, unfortunately for me, like, I just didn't have great expectations on this front from the get-go, and I never thought that this was going to go well, and I always dreaded that if the Dems took over either portion of Congress, that some of that winning was going to stop being so much winning, not just because obviously they're going to try to roadblock anything that a GOP president does, but also because of just Trump's past behavior. It's really easy to talk a big talk when it's all of your, mostly your supporters that are having to back you up. It's a lot harder. And like we saw with so many other things over, even before he was in politics, where he kind of wishy-washy and flip-flops, I wasn't real confident in this fight from the get-go. And I'm not very confident about future fights. They all kind of make me nervous. And I don't, and we know that the Democrats are going to be dirty and that they're going to undercut and undermine every way they can anyways. And so I'm not trying to say anything good about them. Do not get me wrong. My hands are just kind of up in the air right now. I'm just kind of like, over all of it.
Yeah, I mean, I have to agree with you. I'm pretty much over it, too. Speaking of over it, it's about time for us to take a break, because we haven't been doing very good with those lately. So
I know, we have not.
So we're going to queue up a break here really quick, and then we will come back after these commercial messages. You are listening to the Jen and Rick Show. We are live right now on KLRNradio.com, where liberty and reason still reign. We will see you guys in just about 3 minutes, so don't go away.
Was in the Army back during Desert Storm, but even then he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq. Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now, 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Attention business owners and independent contractors. This is a money-saving message from Tax Mediation Services. If your business owes $20,000 or more in taxes, we can help you today, right now. Listen, dealing with the IRS is no picnic. It's an intimidating and extremely stressful process, and you don't want to go it alone. Our attorneys know every law, every tax break, and every possible opportunity to help you resolve and reduce your tax debt. And if you owe more than $20,000, you may be at the top of their hit list. So don't take your tax debt lightly, because it will not go away on its own. The IRS can seize your bank accounts, your home, and even shut down your business. Call our tax experts today at 1-800-783-0810 and let us deal with the IRS while you focus on your business. That's 1-800-783-0810. Again, that's 800-783-0810.
So when we're hanging out on the breaks, we can actually turn the commercials off so we can like talk to each other and discuss articles. And occasionally I kind of forget that the break's only 3 minutes, so there may have been some dead air there. I was actually talking with Jen about an article that I just saw from National Review Online. Apparently on January 17th, the abortion provider Planned Parenthood kind of got a smackdown from the Fifth Circuit. Basically, they systematically dismantled a lot of Planned Parenthood's talking points and actually reaffirmed Texas's decision to remove them from their Medicaid providers for their illegal activity that was apparently uncovered in some videos that, you know, they later tried to discredit and said it's not as bad as it seems. So, I mean, the ruling also mentioned parts of the video footage in which Planned Parenthood were admittedly caught in illegally altering abortion procedures to obtain intact fetuses whose organs could then be sold to medical research firms for greater profit. This included finding ways to circumvent the federal ban on partial birth abortion, whether by changing the way they perform late-term procedures or by signing a form saying they had not intended to retrieve an intact fetus. This decision is a win for pro-life efforts to remove Planned Parenthood's medical funding at the state level, but it also affirms evidence showing that Planned Parenthood's doctors and affiliates did indeed break federal law.
Well, the Fifth Circuit is the best circuit, so this doesn't surprise me too much. And by that, I just mean it's the circuit, obviously, that's that Texas belongs to, because that's why they are ruling on this Texas case. I'm kind of surprised I didn't hear more about this, but maybe it's because it was being drowned out by the cheers for late-term abortion in New York last week. And then also, I don't know if you saw about the Virginia bill that has been proposed that would also allow for abortion, even if the woman is in labor.
Yeah, no, I just actually started hearing about that on For Immediate Release last night. Liz and Bill were actually talking about the New York law that just got passed, because they're both from there, and how outraged they were. And they shot me an email earlier today asking me at some point to put out a tweet about the fact that they had that discussion on their show and how appalled they are about the Virginia ruling. I actually just saw that email, so I haven't had a chance to do it yet, but I will be doing that at some point, either tonight or tomorrow. Virginia, am I the only one that just gets sick to my stomach? I mean, I get it. I'm the first one to tell you that I don't want us to go back to rusty coat hangers and back and dark back alleys. But to get it to the point where, I mean, this law in New York is ludicrous. I haven't even looked at the Virginia one yet, but I've read the bill. I have a friend who is actually going to be on tomorrow night's show on America Off the Rails, who's also read the bill from open to close, and it just does so many things that just fly in the face of everything that Roe v. Wade actually stood for. Like the fact that...
The New York bill, you mean?
Yeah, the New York bill. It just flies in the face of everything that Roe v. Wade stood for. Because the whole idea for Roe v. Wade was safe, legal, and rare. I mean, New York at this point is actually opting for the point where they could use postpartum depression or the fear of postpartum depression as an actual medical justification for terminating a pregnancy in the third trimester based on how this law is written.
Yeah, it's even more broad than that. Physical, emotional, psychological, familial, and age all fall under this umbrella of a threat to a mother's health that a practitioner may consider to deem an abortion necessary at any point in the pregnancy up until the moment of birth. So you can understand that when they include all of those things, if someone is hell-bent on being a late-term abortion provider, they will justify anything as an emotional affront to their health, as a psychological affront to their health. This is just—it's just absolutely insane. What a large kind of scope they were given with this. I mean, it really removes all restrictions, basically.
I mean, it's just—I don't understand it. And then I was listening to the ride on the way home yesterday, and they had somebody call in who tried to take another caller to task about their interpretation of the bill, and that's when Chad was like, "Dude, I read the bill. This bill is atrocious. I've read the entire thing. You don't understand what this does. You don't understand." I mean, at this point, the abortions, in according to that bill, don't even have to be performed by doctors anymore.
Right. So that's a big part of it. Yes.
The same people that were, you know, we need abortions to be legal so they can be safe and people can be healthy and blah, 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 blah. You just gutted your own argument because you're basically back to rusty coat hangers and back alleys again, because who the hell cares who does the abortion now as long as it's getting done?
Well, it just absolutely betrays their, you know, farce of, you know, of an argument that they put up for so long, that they don't really want more abortions. They want fewer, which is why we need to have more access and it needs to be less stigma. And that will be what will help have fewer. No, they actually like are in a death cult that wants to promote this as something that is a positive thing. It is absolutely atrocious.
I don't understand how they justify it at this point. I mean, I'm not even coming at this from an attacking perspective anymore. I'm coming from this at an angle of actually trying to understand where these people are coming from. Because at this point, you can't say that a baby within a few days of being born would not be viable outside of the womb. Because that's been their entire argument up until now is, well, when we're talking about doing abortions, there's no way this child could survive without the mom. That's not true anymore. When you're talking about being able to abort a child all the way up to the point where the mom is in labor, you cannot tell me that this isn't something that flies in the face of every argument you've ever told me about why abortion needs to be a thing, because it's not a clump of cells anymore. It's an actual person at that point.
And also, the idea that this is about the mother's health is just... It's just complete poppycock. It is so very, 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 very rare that when in labor, the mother has to make the choice, me or the child, for her actual well-being. That does not happen very often, or in this country, that does not happen hardly ever. So to be like, it would only be used in the rarest of circumstance in which the mother's life and the child's life is threatened and only one could be saved. That is so not a typical thing. And it's not even, it's not something we need a law for that's already covered. You know, I mean, they would try to save both, obviously, but that's already covered. And likely, much more likely the case is that they can save both, but you just don't want the baby anymore for whatever reason. Well, that's just too damn bad. You've already gotten there. So this same thing in Virginia, it's called the Repeal Act because it would remove all existing restrictions on abortion in Virginia. This says that includes permitting abortion in the last 3 months of pregnancy, eliminating informed consent and clinic safety requirements. Eliminating clinic safety requirements. Like, what is wrong with these people? Permitting late-term abortions to be performed in outpatient clinics and removing pro-life initiatives such as ultrasound requirements and a state 24-hour waiting period. It would allow the Virginia House Majority Leader acknowledged that it would allow abortion even at the very end of pregnancy when a woman was in labor. So here's a part of... I'm just going to read this real quick. Well, if it will not go schizo on me, just a part of the back and forth because it got very, I've watched the video and it's very just uncomfortable, but, and you can see where I'm like, see, do y'all get why this is so outrageous when you have to say it out loud and defend it in front of people? But here's a small part of kind of went on. Gilbert says, so how late in the third trimester could a physician perform an abortion? This is the House Majority Leader. And then the next person responding is one of the people that proposed the bill. So how late in the third trimester could a physician perform an abortion if he indicated it would impair the mental health of the woman? They say, or physical health. Okay, but I'm talking about mental health. They said, I mean, through the third trimester. The third trimester goes all the way up to 40 weeks. So to the end of the third trimester. Yes, I don't think we have a limit in the bill. Gilbert says, so where it's obvious that a woman is about to give birth, she has physical signs that she's about to give birth, that would still be a point which she could still request an abortion if she was so certified. Pause. She's dilating. Tran says, Mr. Chairman, you know what would be a decision that the doctor, the physician, and the woman would make. Gilbert says, I understand that. I'm asking if your bill allows that. Tran says, my bill would allow that. Yes. So if, and I don't know, This part of the reason that this worries me is there are several forms of kind of temporary mental conditions that can help, that can affect pregnant women. And think about even like having postpartum depression, things like that. There's stuff that can set in before that that can affect a woman to where she's not exactly thinking the way that she normally would. And so a doctor, you know, if she's not and decides all of a sudden, I can't do this and I don't want this baby, and the doctor could just say, well, I don't think she's mentally prepared, so we're going to go ahead and do this, and she's 39 weeks pregnant. That is absolutely outrageous. You are then killing a human child. There's absolutely zero reason this child is not viable outside the womb. You are actually, if you don't already think it's murder, that is freaking murder. There is no other way around it, because there is absolutely no difference between that baby and that baby a week from then, or the next day, or the babies that are in the NICU right now, or babies that have just been born right now. There is absolutely no difference. That is, I mean, it is astounding to me that, and she tried to dance around it some, but it's astounding to me that there are people in the United States of America right now that can stand up and say that and not see what a travesty it is.
Yeah, it's pretty scary. Speaking of pretty scary, this is probably not going to seem like a big deal to some, but it's a big deal for me. This just came in from Fox News. New draft of proposed changes have Dems set to strike So Help You God from oath taken in front of key House committees. So a key committee in the Democratic-controlled House of Representatives is moving to eliminate the God reference from the oath administered to witnesses testifying before the panel as part of new rules packages expected to approve this week, according to draft obtained exclusively by Fox News. The draft shows that the House Committee on Natural Resources would ask witnesses to recite only, "Do you solemnly swear to affirm under penalty of law that the testimony that you are about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth." The rule proposed places the words "So help you God" in red brackets, indicating they are slated to be stricken. The words under penalty of law are in red, indicating the Democrats propose to add that phrasing to the oath after omitting the other. The draft rules also remove the phrase "his or her" throughout the document, changing those two pronouns to "their." The rules additionally modify all references to the committee's chairman to instead refer only to the committee's chair. Other rules changes relate to expanding the committee's authority over natural gas in Alaska and fossil fuel resources. While many federal oaths do include the phrase "So help me God," some, most notably the presidential oath of office, do not. The full committee is set to vote on the new language this week, and the rules would take effect immediately if adopted. Other committees were still in the process of finalizing their new rules on Monday.
Oh, gosh. I hate this crap. It's so annoying. And you know what? I would like to know, because I know this is the case in most places where you're taking a note, that if there is a God mention there, that it has been for a long time optional. No one's forced to say it that way if they would rather swear on something else other than a Bible. They've been allowed to do that for a long time now. So this just seems like a way to like really stick it. So I just really hate that. Can't we just keep some traditions? And then if you don't want to participate in that tradition, well, there's an alternative for you. That seems perfectly reasonable. But it's been this way for so long, and that's so annoying. I really am more annoyed by the pronouns.
Yeah, honestly, me too. Because I don't know where we are right now. That basically we're now where it's okay in New York to like rip babies out of the womb, but you know we still have to recognize the fact that apparently there are 9 billion genders. I don't understand.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not to pull the Christian card, but I'm ready for Jesus. I'm just saying. I'm pretty much over all this crap. I'm not even playing anymore.
Well, and that's why, like, on that other stuff, like, the God stuff is annoying, but it doesn't really bother me all that much because, first of all, there are a lot of places where we don't use that. And, you know, technically, like, we are a Christian-founded nation, but we do not have a designated religion officially. And also, I don't think God cares if we're using that in the halls of our government or not. He cares about what the people are doing in their lives and with their hearts. So that part of it, it's obnoxious, but it's not as big of a deal to me as some of the other crap they're trying to shove down our throats.
Yeah, so another little interesting side note with all this congressional crap. Did you know that AOC is actually on two separate committees? As a freshman?
Yes.
And we're not talking like the little, you know, little fly-by-night committees, kind of like the one we were just talking about, like the Natural Resources Committee. We're talking about choice committee placements. It's getting to the point now where she's actually starting to piss off her constituents, because there have been not her constituents, but her fellow congressmen and women, because there are people that have been there much longer that are like, she's on two committees and I can't even get on one. What the hell?
Right, but she's the media darling and she's the little, you know, face of young Democrats right now. And of course, anyone who has left us enough to even entertain and flirt with the idea of socialism, then she is absolutely numero uno. Move over, Bernie. Sorry, no one liked your brand, but really love hers. It's really ridiculous. I know there are a lot of people that don't, but there's already rumors of her being primaried, of them looking for someone to primary her, because she's, you know, she's definitely ticked off some of the ruling class, I think, some of the people that are the establishment types. But I just wish that it ticked them off because she's outrageous and ridiculous, instead of because she's snagging the spotlight and because she's going off script. I wish that they were doing it because she's actually bad for the country and she's batshit crazy.
Yeah, that would be nice. But, you know, they're more concerned about the fact that she's stealing the spotlight. Mm-hmm. I had something else I was going to say about her, and I don't remember what it was now. Oh, well, must not have been that important.
Oh, my gosh. And she still has such crazy eyes.
Hey, that's not necessarily a bad thing. I got a crazy
no.
eye myself.
No.
Well, no, she has psycho eyes. I just have one that doesn't seem to know what the hell it's doing.
that's totally different. She has possessed crazy eyes. Possessed by a demon eyes. I don't know. It's insane. I can't. I have a hard time watching her talk at all because she's like, bleh! I'm like, oh my gosh. And I just, of course, I wish they would just turn it down a notch with her, but no. And then it's hard not to respond because she's so ridiculous. But I did not think that we would have another politician on the scene whose, you know, skin was thinner than Trump's and Obama's. But here she comes along and she sure is giving them a run for their money.
So what did you think about her spouting off the other day about how she agrees with the founding fathers because they were opposed to billionaires too?
I about wanted to vomit. Oh my gosh, I did a little thread.
You did a thread?
I was just
imagine
being
that.
Stupid. I was like, I was just being really dumb, but I was like, oh, what did I say? I think it was pretty funny that I was saying, like, you know, like Hamilton would want a duel over, like, you know, some people were saying like Washington would have shot her. And I was like, no, Washington wouldn't have even given her the time of day for a response. Like he never would have entertained an audience with her. He would have spoken to her. He would not have spoken about her. I said, Adams is already bitter enough without having some harpy woman telling him what he did or didn't think. I was just going through all of them. Like, Hamilton definitely wants her to shut the hell up and is like, who the hell is this crazy person and why are they here? All of that is just so gag-worthy. This, like, and I actually, I don't like it ever when people try to compare modern politicians with our founders. There's never going to be anybody like them. No one is ever going to be able to write, speak, or think like they did in any sort of meaningful way that works for modern society. And And I really just think that it cheapens who they were, what they sacrificed, what they lived through, and how they fought, literally fought and bled, and many died in order to form this government that they are so flippant with, and our current politicians are so flippant with, and so, you know, just so arrogant about comparing themselves or their colleagues to these absolutely, you know, once in history men. I mean, there is no comparing, and it just makes me so aggravated that happens at all, but particularly when it happens with a dumb little, just naive socialist POS like her. Sorry, I have feelings.
Yeah, well, I mean, you're allowed, but the thing that I love is the fact that they took all of these things that were written or by one of the founding fathers when they were visiting France and took them and completely twisted it into trying to draw modern allegories for today. Because what they were actually referencing, as far as, you know, people that they felt weren't doing enough with their money, were the aristocracy, because those people were actually in charge of the people that were living on their land, and they were refusing to invest in allowing them to be able to make their lives better, even though they were under their charge. If anything, right, that allegory relates to her group now, Congress, because they're doing nothing to make the American people's lives better. It doesn't have a damn thing to do with millionaires.
Yeah, I mean, that's the whole thing, is it's like they're talking about nobility and aristocracy and this social hierarchy based on wealth that often was not earned and that was, you know, generational. They were not talking about someone who built up their own wealth. I mean, it's absolutely ridiculous. And I know, you know, we're never going to get rid of the silver spoon brats. Like, there's just always going to be those people out there. But it's just absolutely ridiculous, because so many of the American billionaires and millionaires are absolutely self-made, or at least within one or two generations of family members that made them and then moved from there, you know, moved on from there with that wealth to make it better too.
Oops, forgot I was muted. Yeah, again, I don't understand how we got here, because the fact that she can basically just take a few words put together by a founding father, completely twist them on their head and say, look, this proves that they didn't like billionaires either. You're missing the point. They didn't like billionaires in positions of authority that were basically usurping off of their citizenry, which is exactly what you're talking about trying to do with a 70% tax rate, you moron. Wait, I'm sorry. Was that out loud? My bad.
Well, I mean, it's truth. The way in which that they are talking about wealth as being amoral, and then they're talking about taking wealth as moral, and that they're trying to frame this argument in that way about, like, as if this is the moral and ethical thing to do. I have to believe that even if there are people that like a lot of ideas that come from that kind of leftist socialistic ideology, that when it really comes down to it with that part of it, go, I mean, make it about the greater good in this, but don't say that it's like amoral to have money at all. And what I mean by that is when it really comes down to what they'll have to offer, what they'll have to sacrifice, and what they'll actually be taxed on. I mean, all the time, Democrat friends of mine are like bitching about what's taken out of their paycheck. And I'm like, and you live in one of the most tax friendly states. And I'm going, yet at the same time, like, you voted for Obama, you were voting for Clinton, you probably are cheering on AOC right now. So next time that you're thinking about these tax rates and you're thinking about the millionaires and the billionaires that are going to get hit by it, remember that it never is just them. It's always going to be you that suffers too. And at some point, you're going to be deemed to have too much, because when does it stop? You know, we go from who needs a yacht and who needs a Maserati to who needs a Lexus to who needs a Kia to who needs a car anyway. And it just goes downhill so fast from there to justifying this kind of absolute ridiculous ideology. I just can't. I can't believe we're still arguing about this level of socialism in 2019 after all the suffering at the hands of it over the last 100 years. It just blows my mind.
Yeah, you know, it really does boggle my mind, because one of the scariest things about all of this is the simple fact of the matter is, we know, based on history, that socialism doesn't work. Even places where they say it works. Because, you know, now I have people from Canada all the time coming into my feed about how great their healthcare system is compared to ours. You know, I was reading a news story the other day about somebody in Canada who actually is having heart trouble. And they have been removed from their job and placed on bed rest by the Canadian government. And they've told them that they will get them in for very extensive testing in as little as 5 months.
Ugh. Ugh, ugh, ugh.
Because, you know, the socialized medicine is the best idea ever. And the worst thing is, you know, we've been talking about, like, the issues in Great Britain where they've been taking people off of life support because, you know, suffering is bad. Those things are starting to happen here. And we're not paying enough attention to the fact that they're starting to happen here. Because at some point along the way, compassion, the idea of what compassion is, has changed. Because now in certain places, you know, compassion is, well, we're going to give you this test that we're only sure is about maybe 45% accurate. But if it says that your child may have Down syndrome, we're going to encourage that you abort that child, even though we're not 100% sure that that test is accurate. So there's certain places, like I believe it was Scandinavia, that it claims to have nearly obliterated Down syndrome in their population. But it's because they've been basically using basically eugenics, because they've run a test that says, well, this person is going to be flawed, so they don't deserve to exist. By their logic, I wouldn't deserve to exist.
Well, right, and well, it gets even kind of more gruesome than that. People that are already alive, you know, someone who is, like you were saying, like someone who is a little bit more elderly, and they maybe need, you know, long-term dialysis in order, but they can survive another 10 years if they get it. But going, well, no, we're just going to make you comfortable and put you on pain meds until you pass. I mean, you know, because it's not worth it for that cost to them, because, well, you've lived a good life. You're 70, even though that person might live to 85, you know, or a transplant of some kind or some other sort of treatment. And then where you get put in line on cancer based on your age. And that kind of playing God thing that is just, I don't know how anyone can look at that. And I see people all the time from Europe and from Canada arguing how this is the compassionate thing. And they've been so brainwashed and they are so deluded. They don't even know what they're saying. Like, I truly believe some of these people are really good people that have been completely duped by a bad system and by evilness. And they have learned a certain thing, and it is just ingrained in them that this is the best way for these things to work out. And it's, you know, it's just really sad. And it's something that I hope that there is a significant portion of the United States that will rise up against and will refuse to let that become large scale here.
No, I completely agree. All right, well, believe it or not, we're actually over our 60-minute allotment, which has put us well over the top of the hour because we got a late start. So any last thoughts on the way out the door?
Oh, not really.
Not really?
You know, 2019, extension 2018, it's not getting any better.
Yeah, this is basically 2015, the dumpster fire version 4.
Yeah, basically so.
All right, so why don't you remind
extending
folks,
it.
Why don't you remind folks where it is that they can hang out with you when you're not on the air hanging out with me?
Yep, come find me on Twitter at Jay Homestead. Also check out Misfits Politics on Twitter and misfitspolitics.com.
All right, you can follow along with me on Twitter at Rick73. Go ahead.
Don't KLRN.
Sorry.
I was going to say, and don't forget to follow KLRN Radio on Instagram.
Nice. Actually, follow it on Twitter, too, and Facebook. Actually, click like on Facebook, click follow on Twitter and Instagram. Sorry, for some reason there seems to be some lagging going on all of a sudden because you're like trying to talk and then I'm not hearing you until like 5 or 10 seconds later. But anyway, that's going to do it for this particular episode. I'm going to take about a 5-minute break to do some business and then we're going to reset and start America off the rails because I didn't do a show last night, so I promised everybody I would do one tonight and there is still plenty of stuff I want to talk about. So we'll be back with you here in about 5 minutes. It's going to be a late night, but what the hell. I'm not that old. We can do this. See you guys in a few.